verse number 14. For it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted to them his property. To one, he gave 5 talents. Now, by the way, that word talent there is not like talented, singing, acting, tap dancing. Talent is a denomination of money. So you could just say $5 or $5,000 or whatever amount you'd like to put. You can actually pretend it's $5 million just for reading's sake, but it's 5 denominations of money. So to one, he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, each according to his ability. Then he went away. He who had received the 5 talents went at once and traded with them, and he'd made 5 talents more. So he who had the 2 talents went and did the same, and he got 2 talents more. But he who had received the 1 talent went and dug a hole in the ground to keep it safe, buried it. Now, after a long time, the master of those servants came and settled accounts with them. He who had received the 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 talents more, saying, Master, you trusted me with 5 talents. Here, I've brought you 5 more. I've got 10. The master looks at that servant. He says, well done, good and faithful servant. Okay, I've already lost my place. Well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over a little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master. Here, 2 talents came forward, saying, Master, you delivered or you entrusted me with 2. See, I took it and I worked it and I brought you 2 more. Master says the same exact response. Well done, good and faithful servant. You're faithful with a little. Now you'll be given much. Enter into the joy of your master. Then the 1 talent person shows up on the scene. Dusts off his talent. Gets all the dirt off because he had it buried in the ground. And he said, his master said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. He says, Master, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you scattered no seed. So I was afraid and I hid what you gave me in the ground. See, just like you gave it to me, I'm giving it back to you in the exact same state. He thought he was playing it safe. His master said, you wicked and lazy servant, you wicked, slothful, like, why didn't you just deposit that money in the bank? I could have got 0.003% interest at Bank of America. I could have got something, and instead you brought me back 1 dirty coin. He's like, oh, so frustrating. He says, fine, take the talent from that one and give it to the one that's got 10, because that one that's got 10 knows how to take care of what I've given them. He says, for everyone who has, more will be given, and he will have an abundance. But from he who has not, even what he has will be taken away. We're going to talk today just for a few moments on the subject of on the edge of something beautiful. On the edge of something beautiful. I was, by the way, going to call it Cash Me Outside. Just for, like, when people are, like, Googling stuff, they'll find that, and they'll be looking for a fight. And they find Jesus. You know, I'm just trying to reach people. Just trying to reach people. Okay, let's pray. Jesus, thank you for your word. God, I'm praying that today that you'd speak to us from your word. God, as we go through this story and other stories in your word, I'm praying today, God, that you would talk to us. God, that you would talk to us from your word. And that we'd leave this place changed. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Look at that person next to you. Say, man, you look so good for a Sunday. You look so good for a Sunday. May not say that on a Monday, but you look so good for a Sunday. On the edge of something beautiful. On the edge of something beautiful. Those of you that that don't know, my wife and I, we have a 4-year-old little boy, and his name is Winston, and he's just the pride and joy of my life. I love him so much. My Instagram is just, like, all him, and, like, I just want to kiss his face so much. He's amazing. And his line that he says right now when he doesn't want to do something or if something is difficult is, like, I'm like, hey, buddy, can you go carry that box of toys back in your room? Hey, buddy, can you carry this jar over to your mom? Hey, buddy, can you help me carry in the groceries from the car? I call him Buddy if you haven't caught on. I'm like, who's Buddy? It's a new character in this story. And his line is, Daddy, I can't. I'm not very good at it. I'm not very good at it. And I don't correct him on like some of his speech impediments because they're so cute, right? You just try to keep him. I just, sometime before he's like 27, I want to teach him how to say specific words. Like when he says tomorrow, he says tomorrow. He's like, Daddy, tomorrow? I'm like, uh-huh, tomorrow. I don't correct him. I just let it ride. He doesn't know how to say like the next day. So instead of saying the next day, he says on a sunny day, which somehow is translated into his four-year-old mind that that means the next day. So he's like, Daddy, on a sunny day, I have an idea. We can wake up and have biscuits and eggs and watch my iPad. That's always like his ingenious idea. And then we could just watch my iPad and play games on my iPad. And I'm like, nah, maybe on another sunny day, buddy. The other day, he's like, he said this line to me because he has his cousins in town. And he's like, Daddy, I don't know how to drive a car, and I don't know how to climb a tree. I have to get taller. Those are the two things he says he didn't know how to do because he has no idea what it takes to do either of those things. It was funny that his cousins were in our backyard, and they were, like, climbing a tree. And it's not really, like, a tree. I think it was, like, a fig tree or something. And it was, like, one of those trees that, like, someone planted, like, 30 years ago on accident. And it's just kind of, like, grown. And it's, like, halfway in my neighbor's yard, but, like, whatever. So his cousins, like, climbing up these trees. And they know how to climb. And he's just, like, sitting there at the bottom, like, looking up at them. And part of the reason is I don't want to teach him how to climb a tree because I know that there's only two ways for him to get down from that tree when you're learning how to climb a tree. One is screaming, Dad! Dad! And he's like stuck. And so I got to climb a tree now, like almost 35. So I got to climb a tree as a grown man, wave to the neighbors, hey, just climbing a tree and help him down. Or if I don't hear him yell, Dad, his cousins will come running inside saying, Uncle, Uncle, Winston fell out of the tree. So there's only two ways to get down from a tree when you're a kid, is Dad getting you out or you fall and get hurt. At least those are the only two ways I knew as a kid to get out of a tree. One time, no joke, one time I was jumping out of a tree because I thought that'd be a good idea. And my ankle got caught in like one of the branches. And so my sisters had to go inside and my dad came out and I was just hanging upside down. People thought I was a pinata. It was very difficult. Just hanging upside down. But he thinks, the funny thing is, Winston thinks that certain things are really easy for me because he doesn't know the investment that I've had to do to get to that level. Like, he thinks driving is easy because he's never been to the DMV. On Tuesday, my license expires. In case there's any law enforcement in the room, I'm going to take care of it. I just want you to know right now, I'm going to take care of it. And I did Uber to church this morning just in case. But on Friday, I was telling Vanessa, my wife, I was like, babe, today's the day I'm going to go in for my test. I'm going to do it. And so we made it a family affair. Like, we weren't thinking. And so we're like, hey, let's all go. It should be quick. And so we get to the DMV and Winston, our boy, falls asleep right as we're pulling up. And so I'm like, oh, this is great. I'll just hold him and like, he won't have to suffer through this DMV moment. And so I'm holding him, and now he's not a baby anymore. Like, you know, baby, it's like having a purse. It's like an accessory. Like, they just kind of do what you tell them to do, like, stay. And they're like, eh. Like, that's all they know. Like, be cute. Like, they just got it. Now, toddlers, they're like moving and squirming, and what's that guy, and why does he look weird? What's that smell? I was like, son, just because it's legal doesn't mean it's right, okay? And so I'm holding him for his entire nap. He's literally drooling all over me. Like, because he's just like this. And he's kind of doing the sack of potatoes thing. Like, I couldn't even get an arm over the top. Like, he wasn't helping me at all. He was just doing this. And so I'm holding him. Like, it was so bad that people in line were feeling bad for me. Like, do you want to switch me spots? Like, I'll take your, which has never happened. I was like, man, God's real. God is so real. Showed up at the DMV. So he wakes up, he finishes his entire nap. I'm still in line to the first line. I didn't know that there was multiple lines. That was the line for my next line. So I get up there and I'm like, hey, I gotta take a driver's test. It's like me and all these like 15-year-olds. Hey, how's it going, man? They're like, is your mom and dad here? I'm like, just check my ID, I'm good. And so I have to like prove like my life story to them. And they're like, okay, here's your number. You get to go sit in this other section and wait again. I'm like, oh my gosh, this is amazing. This is amazing. And that's because that's the only thing I could say. And so waited in that next line, and I get up to the window, and the lady's like, oh, these are the wrong documents. I'm like, ma'am, the first hour and a half line I waited in, they said it was cool. I'm hoping that you will say the same, because I have drool on me. I've got a toddler that I've been trying to keep from touching the gum underneath the chair, and I'm kind of a germaphobe, so I'm already freaked out. And so I was like, please just take my money, take my documentation. And she's like, cool, here's your next number to go wait in the next line. And so 3.5 hours later, we left. And so I've the good news is, you guys, the good news is I have the first half of my driver's license done. I still get to go back and take the test because I didn't have another hour and a half to wait in that other line. So Winston thinks driving is easy because he slept through the entire investment. He has no idea the lines that I waited in, the people that I batted my eyes at and were like, please, please just switch me. And they switched me. He has no idea the investment that his dad made to get that driver's license. He just says, I'm not very good at it. I'm not very good at it, Daddy. You do it, Daddy. You do it. He's like, I have an idea, Daddy. Why don't you do it? I'm like, buddy, the reason why Daddy doesn't want to do it is because I want you to get better at it. Because you need to not be so reliant upon Daddy because your baby sister's coming and your job is to be a helper. He's like, well, Daddy, I'm not going to mow in the lawn, but son, I'm teaching you because I want you to get good at mowing the lawn. I'm just kidding. He doesn't mow the lawn. I'm just kidding. He doesn't mow the lawn yet. But sometimes people will look at you and look at your life and they think that you do something and it comes so easy to you. And the only reason why they think it's easy is because they don't know the work that you've put in to get to the place that you are at today. A couple people that have put in work were clapping. They're like, people don't know. They don't know how difficult it was to finish that degree. They don't know how difficult it was to be a single parent. They don't know how difficult it was to keep that relationship alive. They don't know those sleepless nights that you stayed at the office and everyone else went home. They don't know. And so they may say, oh, it's easy for that person, but it's difficult for me. But it's only because they don't know the investment that you have had to put into that thing to get to where you are at. Thank you. I agree. So we've been over the last couple weeks talking about unlocking your dream. And I hope you picked up the book. I hope you bought copies for friends. I hope you've read it. I hope you've put it on the inside of your heart, because we all have not just a dream, but you can have multiple dreams. If you remember from last week, it's like, do you have a dream? And it's like, yeah, which one? Because I got a Monday dream, I got a Tuesday dream, I got a Wednesday dream. Catch me outside, I'll tell you my Thursday dream, tell you my Friday dream. You don't even want to see my Saturday dream. You can't handle my Sunday dream. Oh, I got dreams. But the problem is many people, they have dreams and they're locked away in their heart. They're locked away in a journal, or they're locked away in a blog, or they're locked away in a coffee shop conversation, and they've never yet realized the dream. They're standing on the edge and looking out at something beautiful, but they're locked in a dream. Because in order for that dream to become a reality, there's risk involved. There's possibility of failure involved. There's humiliation involved. You ever remember going to like the middle school or high school dance? You guys know where I'm going, right? You're standing up there against the wall with your boys, playing it cool, drinking my punch, You're playing it cool, and then you see the girl that you've had a crush on all year, and you know that there's this massive gap between you and them. You know that there's like literally border patrol, there's all kinds of stuff between you and the rest of them. And that when you, in order for you to be like, man, I'm gonna do it, it's cool and it's easy to say, I'm gonna ask her to dance. But until you take that first step, and then sometimes guys take a first step, like, oh, psych, you guys thought I was gonna, man, I ain't crazy. Watch this, like it's a pit bull on a chain, like, oh, you think, how close can I get? How close can I get? Still holding on to base, how close can I get? But some people there would rather talk about a relationship than actually take the risk to ask that person out. They would rather blog about having a business than going and putting in an application or going back to school. Some people would rather talk about or dream about these things, and the problem is that they would rather stay back in the safety of a dream than actually walking out and living out that dream. Their dream is now prisoner in this pit of possibility. They're stuck saying things like, oh, someday, man. Someday. Oh, you know what? I've got a dream. I want to start a business. You know what? I want to start a relationship. I want to start this. I'm going to serve someday. I'm called to preach, or I'm called to sing, or I'm called to do this, or someday I'm going to do this, and someday I'm going to do that, and someday never becomes today, and the possibilities get stuck in a pit. This story in Matthew is the story of Jesus explaining the kingdom of God. Now, Matthew, to many, is called the book of the king because we see Jesus portrayed as king. It starts out, it's one of the, there's only two gospels that include the birth of Jesus, Matthew and Luke. And Matthew starts out the story while, like, Luke tells, like, the Christmas story and the shepherds. Matthew includes a story of the wise men. Or the biblical word is the magi. You guys know what I'm talking about? Like, they say the three wise men or something like that. And there's that Christmas song. We three kings of... Yeah, after that, I get lost every time. It's like one of those songs that when people sing it, it seems like it should be like a cheering song. Like, we three... Come on, everybody, just swing your arm. We three kings of... Da, 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 da. We travel afar. Hey, cheers. I feel like I should be on a boat or something with a bunch of sailors, like with beards. Like, we three kings of the... So the wise men, their job were the kingmakers. That's what they were called. And so whenever a king was about to pass away, the magi would come, and they would line up the children, and the magi would say, this is to be the next king. And the magi show up here on the scene in the beginning of Matthew, and they said, we've come to find him who is to be the king of the Jews. Afterwards, Jesus is born, he calls disciples, Matthew chapter 5, Jesus begins to lay out the rules of the kingdom. He's like, oh, you know the rules of your society. You know the speed limits because you've been studying for a test at the DMV. You know these rules, you know these laws, and he says, let me tell you about the rules of the kingdom. Blessed are the pure in heart, they'll see God. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. And he begins to talk to his disciples about, let me tell you what the kingdom is all about. We also see in Matthew two different times, in Matthew 16 and in Matthew 19, Jesus tells his disciples, I've given you the keys of the kingdom so that when you pray, stuff happens. He says, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. He says, I'm giving you the keys to the kingdom. We also see throughout Matthew that Jesus tells stories, and he says, this is how Matthew 25 starts. He goes, well, the kingdom of heaven, it's like this. And he begins to explain it. He says, the kingdom of heaven, it's like these 10 women with lamps, and they're keeping them lit. The kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who entrusts 5 talents and 2 talents and 1 talent with people that he trusted. And he says, hey, I'm going to go away for a minute, but when I come back, there's going to be an accounting of what you've done with what I've given you. This is what the kingdom of heaven is like. And Jesus explains that. But 2 thoughts I want to propose to you before we get too far into the sermon, and hopefully these would be thoughts that you would agree with. Maybe you wouldn't agree with externally, or maybe you would agree with them externally, but you would battle with them internally. These 2 thoughts are really foundational to what we're going to talk about today. And number 1 is this, is that you are gifted. And what I mean by gifted is maybe not, we all can't sing in here like Amy and Megan and Marvin. When Marvin sings, I'm like, I'm weeping halfway because it's so beautiful and halfway because I can't do that. Like, why? Like, God, why is he so good? And there's such a distance between us in that point there. But number one, you are gifted. Now, you are gifted by God and you've received an investment from heaven, whether you realize it or not. Whether you recognize it or not, or whether you utilize it or not, you are gifted and you have received an investment from heaven. There's a guy on our Kingdom Builders team, and Kingdom Builders is just one of the ministries that I have the honor and opportunity to work with a team of incredible business people here in the church, that the sole heart and goal of that is God-centered success. Just the God-centered, not just success and marketing, but just God-centered success. And we were talking this last week, and he was telling me, he's like, when I was in college, he's in his 30s, like, when I was in college, I used to be able to find a way to get the CDs and DVDs like months before they had been released. And so I was like, okay. And I was like, so what did you do? So he's like, so what I would do, and he wasn't with Jesus then, so don't judge him. He's like, so what I would do is I would make copies. He's like, and I'd carry them in my backpack. And he's like, I would make a couple $100 a day every day at school. I was like, so-and-so, that's amazing. You were gifted by God. You were just playing for the wrong team. Maybe some of you didn't get that. You've been gifted by God, but some of you have maybe just playing for the wrong team. Maybe someone's watching online. You'll amen louder. You've been gifted by God. You've maybe just been playing for the wrong team. So whether you realize it or not, whether you recognize it or not, you have been gifted by God. Look at that person next to you, say, if you only knew. The second thing that we got to agree on is this, is that there's an intrinsic connection between growth and risk. There is no growth without risk. There's no growth opportunity without risk, without putting a little bit more weight on and seeing, can I do this one more time? With maybe if you're a runner, by just saying, you know what, I'm going to stretch. I'm going to try to push my time just a little bit more. I'm going to try to push myself a little bit more in my school. I'm going to try to push myself a little bit more. And without getting out there, there is no growth without risk. So you are gifted, whether you realize it or not. And growth is impossible without risk. So there's a couple things that keep us locked in a dream, where we're on the edge of something beautiful. We can see the dream, we can see the possibility, we can see the business or the relationship or the right standing or the leadership. We can see those things, but we're caught on the edge of something beautiful. There's three things that will keep you from stepping into that dream. Three things. If you're taking notes, number one is, I'm not good enough. I'm not good enough. We compare our private self with someone else's publicized self. We compare our weaknesses to someone else's Instagram. Have you ever had like a bad day and then you look on social media and someone's like perfect? Like their skin tone is like amazing? And you have some weird growth. You think it's a zit, but you're not sure. And you ask someone else to take a look at it, and then they're on there. They're like, oh, here I am on the red carpet with all these famous people after a prayer meeting with my family. And then before that, we are serving an outreach and doing at the soup kitchen as we do every Friday. And you're like, and here I am, I'm losing it. I don't even have money to like Uber somewhere or Lyft somewhere. And it's like you're like scrounging up change for a bus and you're comparing your private self with someone else's publicized or social media self. You know, comparison will kill the dream of God in your life. Comparison will kill the dream of God for your life. I like that. I may say it a third time. Comparison will kill the dream of God for your life. Looking at what someone else has or looking at what you don't have will kill that dream faster than anything else. Well, why'd they get 5 and I only got 2? Why'd they get 2 and I'm only here with 1? What am I going to do with 1? I can't even split it up into 2 places. I got to spend it at 1 time. Like, I can't even get, like, two things. Like, this guy over here can get a cheeseburger and a fry. I've got one decision. I've got just one choice. I've got to make it count. Comparison will kill the dream of God in your life. There will always be someone who is further along than you. There will always be someone that seems a little bit more spiritual, that seems a little bit further on in their game. They're like, you're like, man, I'm so excited. We've been married for 5 years. And someone's like, oh, that's great. We've been married for 26. And you're like, oh. Guess I'll go take that marriage class. The marriage classes is still, yeah, I guess I'll go take that marriage class thing because I've only got 5 years or something. Because maybe you could help me because you got 26. And then someone else is like, oh, 26. I remember when we celebrated our 26th. How many years ago was that? Honey, how many years? Was that 15 years ago? I forget. Because we've been married for ages now. And the rest of us are like, geez, gosh, I've only got a couple of years. And there's always going to be someone that's way further along than you. I remember this one time, I was driving with a buddy, and I was kind of like his wingman, because it was like him and this girl, and we were going to the wedding, but he didn't want the girl to think that he liked her, so he's like, Wes, can you roll with me? I'm like, sure, whatever. And so they were being like super spiritual, and I'd just like been serving God for a couple years, and they're like, hey, let's memorize the Bible. I'm like, cool, like which part? Like a verse or something? Like one of those small verses, like God so loved the world. Guys, if you need help, I can help you on that one. Mostly I switch it up, I start throwing in thous and thuses, but it sounds good as long as you don't look it up. It sounds really, really good. So we're on this trip. And they're like, verse number one, all right, we got it. And they were like, they picked Romans. And if you don't know the Bible, it's like a legal document. It's really good. It's very theologically deep. But it's just not as easy maybe to memorize for some of us. We're going to this trip and like, all right, verse number one. And they're like, reading it through. And I'm like, all right, cool. And I like kind of got it, like barely enough, like where I could like hold onto it, like with one fingertip, like not like a whole hand, just like one fingertip, like don't pull away because then I don't have it. Just, I got it like this much. And they're like, all right, verse number two. And I'm like, wait, hold up, we're doing more than one? And at this point, I start spinning out of control in my mind. I'm like, oh my gosh, these guys are like super Bible wizards. And they're like, verse number three. I'm like, verse number... I'm like, wait, can we go back to verse one? And so I'm in the back, and I'm like holding the team back. They're like, all right, verse 17. And I didn't know what to do, so I just like fake slept. I was like... Oh, yeah, it was a good drive, man. Good drive. Oh, yes, I would have memorized with you guys, but... fell asleep. It's been a long week. There's always going to be someone further along. There's always going to be someone that seems that they've got it a little bit better. Another reason why people feel like they would be on the edge of something beautiful but locked in a dream is if they feel like that no one will pick them. No one will pick me. Remember when I first started like really serving God, I was at this really small church, and there's like two things you could do to get involved. Actually, there's three. There's like drama team, which I don't know why we did that, but we did. There's drama team, setting up chairs, which I was a pro at, and being on the worship team. So I was like, cool, like I'll sign up for all three. So I was literally in all three. The drama team, I was terrible at it. And then setting up chairs, I'm like, now it's done. It's like, hey, can I be on the worship team? And I remember like one time they were like, hey, like there was only so many mic plugs, you know? I don't know if that makes sense. There's only so many mic plugs, but they had an extra mic or something. So they gave me a mic, and I realized, I was like, I thought I was like leading everyone in worship that day. And I was like, for like the 50 people that were in the room, I was like, man, this like heaven is coming and can hear my voice. And it's like the angels are just like, whoa. They're like, that's their wings, if you didn't know. So it was because I was in drama. That's why I know that. So the angels are like doing this, and I'm like singing my guts out, and then I realized like my mic wasn't even plugged in. And that's why I was like, hey, can you turn me up in the monitor? I can't really hear it. It's because you're not on. And reminds me also, there's a story of this man, and he felt like he had this creative idea. And so he went to this newspaper, and they said, we don't actually think that you're very creative. We don't think that you've got a lot of creativity. This is a newspaper called the Kansas City Star. So he goes to Kansas City Star, tries to get a job, and they say, you're not creative enough. But he's got this idea that he can't shake. And he's got this dream in his heart that he can't shake. And so he goes to some investors and he says, hey, will you invest some money with me to create this dream? And they're like, the Kansas City Star didn't like your ideas. They didn't think you were very creative. It sounds like a risk. It actually sounds pretty stupid to us. Investor after investor, bank after bank, and 302 banks later, he finally got enough yeses to build Disneyland. When Disney eventually bought out ABC, because Disney did buy out ABC, this massive parent company, when Disney bought out ABC, one of their subsidiaries was a small newspaper in Kansas City called the Kansas City Star. The same organization that said, hey, you're not creative enough, he ended up not just owning that, but owning the massive thing. And we get confused with man's choosing and God's choosing, but yet God seems to continually pick people that you and I would never pick. Like if you look at me and if you look at my family, if you look at different things, I don't know if very many of you 10 years or 15 years ago would say, man, that's our first round draft pick. And it's like the rest of us, have you ever been in one of those prayer meetings where someone next to you has gotten prayed for? Maybe you're like one of the really spiritual people in the room and you've gone to a prayer meeting and the person next to you gets like prayed for by someone on the mic and they give them something like really good. They're like praying for them. They're like, you're gonna be amazing. God's gonna give you a great platform. You're gonna be a multimillionaire. And everyone's like looking, are they single? Like what's going on? If you ever stood next to that person and you're like, really God? You're gonna give them everything? Someone else's gift and someone else's dream is not in competition to yours. Oftentimes, it's in conjunction, it's in connection. Come on, conjunction, junction, what's your function? I'm laughing at my own jokes. The last one is this, not enough training. I've not been trained enough. Maybe you don't feel like you've come from the right spiritual pedigree or like, you know, I haven't gone through, I don't know all the Bible verses. I don't have this and I don't have that. And you kind of say, I don't have enough training. There's this guy at the very beginning of the Bible, his name was Moses. And God's people were in slavery. They were in captivity to like this wicked empire that would make them, that would force them to make bricks. And they would like build all these things and they were very cruel to them. And so God's like, I've heard the prayers of my people and I'm gonna rescue them. And so who God chooses, I'm thinking if it's me, I'm picking an army commander. Like, let's go in there. Where's the closest thing to General Patton? And we're gonna send that person in and they're gonna like smash stuff and break stuff and blow stuff up. I don't know, but something that comes in a box and has wires coming out of it. Let's send the person that knows how to operate with that. Let's send them in. And instead, God chooses someone who was somewhat of a reject because he had left the Egyptian culture. And now he's shepherding sheep in the desert. And God says, I found my man. And even Moses is like, God, I'm not good at talking. You want me to go talk to the most important person and to deliver your message? You should have found an orator. You should have found an actor. You should have found a politician. You should have found a general and a poet. You should have found something of the mix. I'm a shepherd in the wilderness. And God says, I found my man. I found my woman. I found the person that I've chosen to bring that thing to pass, to help those people, to lead those people, to do something great. Some of the best ways of training is seeing something done very poorly. Say, well, dad wasn't around, so I don't know how to be a dad. That could be some of the best training that you have. I know the exact wrong way, so I could just do the exact opposite. Instead of hit, I can help. Instead of saying bad words and condemning, I can pray and uplift. Or maybe for you it's something different, like, oh, I wasn't trained financially, I wasn't helped in this way, or I didn't go to school. You know what? For every reason that you and I can come up with a reason of why I don't have enough training, God's still in heaven saying, is my voice not enough? Is my choosing not enough? Caught on the edge of something beautiful, but locked in a dream. It's time that we as a community and every person that maybe you call this place home, maybe you're watching online, or maybe you're here and you're just visiting today, but God's given you something. Heaven has invested something in you, and it has an intention. It has a purpose. And often there are people on the other side who are waiting for you to say yes. Just like the story of Moses, there were people on the other side of his awkward stepping out, where it didn't feel right and it felt awkward and it felt like, ah, I don't have enough training for this, and I don't know if I'm the right person for this, and I don't know if I have the right background for this. And are you sure, God, that you didn't pick someone else? And there are people on the other side that are waiting and begging and praying that you will have the guts to take those 5 talents, or to take those 2 talents, or to take that 1 talent. And if that 1 talent's all you've got, then you will work that 1 talent until it becomes 2 talents. And then you'll work those 2 talents until they become 4 talents. And you're going to work those 4 talents until they become 8 and 8 into 16 and into 32. There are people on the other side waiting for you to unlock the dream that God's given you. They're waiting for you to not just talk about it, but they're waiting for you to be about it. They're waiting for you to not just talk about a good relationship. They're wanting you to step in and show them this is how much work it actually takes to make a marriage successful and to make a marriage last. They're waiting. I love that this community is filled with amazing people who have been incredibly successful in certain areas, but if you were to sit them down and you were to talk to them, if you were to talk to the couple that leads our marriage class, and Patrick and Dunn, they're amazing people, and you were to sit down and say, tell me your story. You've been married for a long time. Tell me your story. You would hear that it was them just not just standing on the edge of something beautiful. It was something that they had to fight for. And that's why they teach the marriage class. If you were willing to find some of the successful people and kingdom builders and people that built businesses, and you'd see them driving, oh, they drive a nice car. They must have had something going their way. And if you were to just sit and say, tell me your story, you would hear story after story after story. People that said, you know, I started a business and it failed. I started this and it crumbled. And I was sued, and I stayed up late, and I prayed, and I put in prayers, and I sacrificed while other people were watching games, while other people were investing in their clothes. I had to invest into a business, and that is why I'm here 30 years later. You would see people serving, and you'd say, hey, tell me how you play drums like that. And they would say, you know what? I didn't start out this way. I was petrified to get up in front of people. But I said yes to something small. I took that 1 talent and I worked that 1 talent till it became 2. No more standing on the edge of something beautiful and being locked in a dream. The Bible says that all creation, everyone is waiting for the revealing of the sons of God. There's this groaning. There's people out there that are waiting for you to unlock the dream that God has put in your heart. They're waiting for you to take that 1 or that 2 or that 5 and say, okay, this is scary. Whew, here goes. This is scary. Okay, I've got some wisdom. I've got some people. I've got some help. But here goes. This is scary, but I'm going to go back. I'm going to approach the difficult conversation. I'm going to approach that opportunity, or I'm going to approach that school. No more standing on the edge. It's time to unlock my dream. Let's pray today. Jesus, thank you for what you're doing in our community. Thank you for what you're doing in our midst. And we are honored. We are honored. Jesus, my prayer for every single person in this room today is that they would sense your love, they would sense your grace, and that they would sense your choosing today.